Hello everyone, thank you for joining in. My name is Raghuveer and I'm your host for today. And we have a very special guest with us today. So we have Chitra Ananthanarayan. She's a software engineer working with IBM in Bengaluru. And she was diagnosed and treated for cancer during the year 2011, right? Post which she has been cancer free for the last 7 years. And Chitra also actively blogs where she talks about her journey through the treatment and also the diagnosis so that it can benefit other cancer patients. So thank you, Chitra. Thank you for joining us. And so over to you.
Thank you, Raghuveer. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my experience and induce positivity amongst cancer patients. At this moment, I would like to convey my gratitude to my parents, my sister, my relatives, and to the doctors, and to my company who have helped me come through this great journey.
Okay. Thanks, Chitra. So, Chitra, let's move on with the interview. So, to start off with, could you help us understand a little bit more about the diagnosis stage, right? So, before you knew that it was cancer, what was the journey like and what were the symptoms like?
Okay, so it was 2010, in the month of February or so, I suddenly started developing a different taste in my tongue with nothing to do. I mean, there was a different taste in my tongue. That's how it started. And okay. After a period of time, I started hearing some words which nobody spoke. And after a couple of minutes, I'll understand, I'll recognize, oh, nobody has been speaking this. And slowly it started losing consciousness. And I would not know the duration, how long I lost my consciousness. So this was for a few seconds initially, and then it became, you know, it started getting extended up to 30 seconds or a minute. And I was a bit afraid of exposing this inconvenience to my mom. I was wondering, oh my God, what if she gets affected by it? I mean, she has BP. Oh, I don't want to expose it to her. But that was a mistake that I had done. Once my mom found out, she was really concerned and she took me to our doctor. And I got this even in front of him, right in front of him. So he was like, you have to undergo an EEG. You go take your EEG at Manipal Hospitals and get back to me with a report. And the EEG indicated that it was epilepsy. So what I had actually got was seizures, also known as convulsions, which we normally refer to as fits. But I was not able to identify that what I was getting was fits because we've been watching movies where they've been showing fits in a totally different way. So once we identified that it was epilepsy, a doctor asked me to consult one more senior physician, a neuro physician, and I went to that doctor. And he tried to diagnose what problem I had. He started giving me tablets, Valparin, Chrono, but then I did not get all right. And every 2 months I used to consult the doctor, at least I would have got seizures for 3 times. And I don't know when I'll get a seizure. I may get it even when I'm crossing the road. I may get it even when I'm sleeping. I have bitten the insides of my mouth. It was very difficult for me to handle. So the doctor started giving me more and more medicines to stop the recurrence. And he gave different combinations of medicines. So by the time it was October the next year, I was taking around 10 medicines. But then I had the same problem. And one fine day, I got a seizure in the morning and then one more seizure at the night. The thing is, when you take so many anticonvulsants, you get so very sleepy. So if you don't have adequate sleep, you get ending up more seizures. So I had one in the morning and one at night that made me lose my confidence and I started working from home. So then the occurrence of seizures was more after that and we immediately consulted the doctor once again. So he asked me to undergo an MRI at that point. The MRI indicated there was glioma in my brain, in the left frontal region of my brain. So after that, we went to search for a surgeon.
Okay. So from the duration of the first symptoms till the point you took an MRI, so what was that duration? Like how long did it take before you?
Very, very long. It was very, very long. And that should not happen with others actually. See, I missed consulting a second physician. Okay. Had I consulted another neurophysician and had he advised me to take even a CT scan, we could have found out that, we could have found out that tumor. And because I did not do that, The first occurrence was in February 2010, somewhere in February 2010 or January 2010, but yeah, it was diagnosed only in October 2011.
So, could you help us understand, see, since you were diagnosed at a fairly young age, right? So, is this a common sort of a cancer or is it extremely rare amongst, you know, women your age?
Anaplastic astrocytoma is rare, but it doesn't look like it's that very rare. It is rare. It doesn't occur okay. that very frequently, but it does okay. occur. The percentage is less. It does not come in the, you know, in the most occurring forms of cancer, but okay. it is there.
Okay. Okay. So, so could you help us understand? So the first, so in October when the MRI was done and when you were told that there was a tumor in your brain, so what were your first reactions? What were your family's first reactions? Because since you fairly started off at your early part of your career at that point in time, you know?
I was 30 years of age when this diagnosis happened. And it was like for me, I'm just telling you, right, I got seizures even when I was crossing the road, and I had even lost one mobile because I got a seizure. It just dropped off my hand and I forgot it when I recovered from the seizure. And then okay. I'm going home, I'm searching for my mobile, it's not there. So I've even lost my mobile and I faced lots of difficulties due to this. So the moment I got to know that there's something in my brain, and the moment it is removed, I'll be all right, I was all the more happy. I was just excited about getting relief from the seizures. And thankfully, okay. I did not go and Google for glioma. I did not do that. Okay. So the doctor he felt the urgency. The doctor, the neurologist, he said that you have to undergo the surgery as soon as possible. Get admitted today, get your operation, surgery done tomorrow. So we understood that the surgery has to be performed soon. I had this surgery. And all my relatives had come. I should really thank all of them. All my relatives had come all the way from Trichy, and okay. They met before I went in for the surgery. And during okay. the surgery, yes, they called me and they made me read the sheet. They would tell me which row I had to read, and they made me okay. do it some 4 times during the surgery. Okay. Actually, it was not a single block or something. It was mm-hmm. spread through, and it was in the left frontal region that controls vision, speech, and hearing. So okay. that's why they had to do it as an awake craniotomy to ensure okay. that all my sense organs were working. Okay. So, and this went on for nearly 7 to 8 hours. It was nearly, I went in by around 8 a.m. in the morning, and it was 4:30 when I was shifted to the ICU. But the doctors were so good that, right when they took me from the OT, when they were about to take me from the OT, they were informing, mm-hmm. okay, her surgery is over. We are going to mm-hmm. take her to the ICU right now. And they're also saying her relatives are all waiting there for her. Let us show them, show her to them, and we will take. Because okay. I was able to hear all this, I was able to open my eyes. I was able to wave to my relatives, indicating them okay. that I'm okay. And then I went to the ICU. Thankfully, I recuperated really fast. The next okay. day itself, in the same night, I got back to my senses. Okay. The next morning, right? And I was discharged in 6 days' time.
Okay. So was there any further treatment that was recommended, like chemotherapy or any other treatment, or was it only surgery?
So the surgery went on. The surgery went on, and after that, I got to know that it was cancer only when they sent it for the biopsy. They sent okay. it for the biopsy. And when the report came, only then I knew that it was cancer. And okay. Dr. Praveen Ganegi himself advised us to follow up with Dr. Vadiraja for radiotherapy. Okay. And then I had okay. to go in for the chemotherapy. So okay. I did 33 sessions of radiotherapy. There was a gap of 2 weeks between the surgery and the radiotherapy. And before okay. the radiotherapy, I had to undergo another MRI because they okay. had to know where the pieces of tumor were remaining so that they can yeah. treat it accordingly. And it was yeah. difficult for them to come up with a plan because the remaining pieces were also in the most crucial areas of the brain. So yeah. they did come up with a plan for it. And yeah, I had 33 sittings of chemotherapy. So thing okay. is that the time of radiotherapy, the cancerous cells have to be very active such that mm-hmm. they get affected by these rays. Because of that, mm-hmm. they had to give me the medicine temozolomide 1 hour okay. before I did the radiotherapy. And temozolomide causes nausea. So I had to complete mm-hmm. having my 3 hours before I reached hospital. Once okay. I reached hospital, give me temozolomide. I had to okay. wait there for an hour, and then the radiation would go on. The radiation went on for about only 8 to 10 minutes, but I had to lay down on a bench. The treatment would be focused for my brain. I had to close my eyes. I should not move during the treatment, and you know the bench would turn this side, that side. It would go up. All that would happen.
Okay.
So that the rays go to the appropriate places. So some of them had to hear. There were a few that had to come through this side. So you know it was planned and done accordingly. Dr. Vad gave me the radiation treatment.
Okay. So if you could help us understand during radiation and chemo, especially since you had a tumor in the brain, what were the major challenges that you faced during this period?
Okay. So after my radiotherapy completed, I underwent 9 months of chemotherapy. And chemotherapy was like for 5 days each month, 5 consecutive days each month. And for the first 6 months, the dosage was 300 mg and then it was 250 mg. So actually, when I had undergone radiotherapy, I mean, along with that, I had to take chemotherapy as well, right? So at that point of time, right before the treatment, they told me that you will be losing your hair. For the first 4 weeks, all right. After 4 weeks, whenever you wash your hair will fall. It will fall altogether. It will fall like that. Don't worry. Will grow back in 6 months. You don't have to bother about that. They had already informed me about it. So as they mentioned, in 4 weeks time I started losing hair. Apart from this, temozolomide, it causes nausea. So I had to take an anti-vomiting tablet every day. And as a side effect, I would have constipation due to emesis. It was good. I did have a lot of constipation at that period of time. And also, because of taking steroids, I started bulging. I was swollen. My cheeks were swollen. My body was swollen. And I started getting sores in my face and, you know, breast because of the steroids itself. I mean, some of the side effects occur for some side effects do not occur for some people. But these were the side effects that occurred to me. But my doctors were very helpful. Whenever I went to them and requested, you know, for the treatment, they immediately attended. And also the patients who were undergoing treatment were in a way that they could induce positivity in me. So there would be one 50-year-old person or a 60-year-old person who would have come all alone by himself for radiotherapy. He will come and watch the cricket match going on in the television, go and take his treatment, come back. He'll go close to the television, find out what the score is, and then he'll go back home. So I could not go alone because mine was in the brain. So I had to always have somebody accompany me. But there were people like this due to whom we felt more, I have to be like this person. Look at his age and how he's behaving. I have to also be like this person. So there were people who induced, you know, such kind of positivity in us.
There were two very important points that you touched upon during this, right? The first one where you talked about having a positive mindset during treatment, right? The example of the old man that you gave. You know, I think that a lot of patients did mention that. You know, when the patient has a positive outlook towards the treatment, there is a higher chance that the treatment, they would also respond better to the treatment, right?
Yes,
and
that's true.
Yes. And also the second thing is in terms of your professional life, right? So since you had such a prolonged treatment, I know that it would have been a challenge to manage your expectations professionally as well, since you are in a very high demanding job, right? So how could you emphasize a little more on how the company accommodated your treatment and ensured that you could stay on board?
It is very important that a company helps patients when they are diagnosed with this. Okay. It's very, very important. So during my treatment, my team members and my manager and my second line manager, all of them came to hospital to meet me. And my management was very, very, IBM's management itself, I should say, they are very, very supportive. They immediately promised me 3 months of leave because I had undergone such a major surgery. And I was on leave during my surgery and during radiotherapy. It was impossible for me to work. So I did have a leave. And even after that, it was not possible for me to, you know, concentrate or you know, give productive hours for 8 or 9 hours. I could only do it for 5 or 6 hours. But they were still very accommodative. Had I lost my employment, right, I would not have had my health insurance. at the age of 29, 30, you don't expect that something like this would come to you. And it's a huge expenditure, right? So because I was on my job roles and I had my health insurance, it was possible for me to spend that much amount of spend that amount for my treatment. I had a feeling in ourselves that this company has kept me on roles. They've done so much for me. We should also do more for our company and we should also achieve. So what were best I could do for my company, I would do today. So I kindly request each company to keep people who are, you know, diagnosed with this with them itself, so that you know it would help the employee, and they would also definitely benefit due to their employee at a later stage. It's not that the person becomes useless, you know, after treatment. That point has to be first understood.
Yeah, I think that's a very fair point. It's very important for the companies to also support the patients through, you know, through this journey in whichever way possible. And so, could you also emphasize a little bit on the role of your family during this stage, right? How did your family, relatives, like you mentioned how your relatives had dropped down, all of them. So if you could just explain a little bit on that.
See, my family did all that was necessary for me. Okay, like my father, my mom, she used to give me my tea, come with me to the upstairs. I mean, we used to go to the terrace in the morning for a small walk that time. Uh-huh. She used to come with me to the terrace and she used to do whatever was possible from her side for me. My father used to take me to the hospital every day for treatment. By the time I came back, I used to have hot food because you see, it was like 4.5 hours since I had my breakfast when I come for my lunch. 3 hours I had to wait. And after taking the tablet, I had to wait for an hour, then take the treatment and then come home. So my parents were very, very supportive to me and they always helped me in all ways possible. And my sister, she too, whenever it was possible for her to take leave and come, she would come here and be supportive. So right before my chemotherapy began, she came and she spent some time with me. So she was also very helpful. All my relatives, whenever it was possible for them to come and make a visit and talk to me, they would definitely do that. And all of them were very positive to me and they never considered me as a burden. They never used to behave in any negative way to me. And they never used to treat me like a patient. They just considered me, you know, as a normal human being. And they spoke to me, we could go out, whatever, in whatever way I was able to cooperate with them. They just took it and they treated me very normally with lots and lots of affection. And that played a important role. Yes, I should specifically mention thanks to my doctor, Dr. Praveen Ganigi, because he told me every day you wake up in the morning, tell to yourself 100 times, I'm all right, I'm all right. And do the same thing every day before you go to sleep. He has induced a lot of positivity in me. And my doctors never, you know, complained me or informed me that you have such a serious form of cancer. You know, it's going to be very difficult for us to make you get all right. They never showed any panic on their face. And they never, none of them ever used the C word. No, that's most important. You know, it's that word that causes a lot of disturbance than anything else. Most of them avoid the word. And that had its impact as well.
So, but after the treatment process, right? How long does it take for you to get back to your, again, you know, full-fledged to your professional life, to your, you know, personal and your social life? Like, how long did it take for you to get and adjust to that?
So during my treatment, right, due to this nausea and all, I was not able to even have outside food. Smell of some, you know, masala smell and all that caused nausea to me. So I was not able to travel either. And as I told you, I had speech difficulties. It was difficult to recollect words. It was difficult to react spontaneously to what was told to me. I think it took me around, 1 or 1.5 years to get back to the actual form I was before. And after that, it is possible to be normal. Of course, the anticonvulsants that were given to me, I told you that I was taking 10 anticonvulsants. Two more were added. Frisium was added. And it took 4 years, nearly 4 years for the doctor to make it come only to Frisium. Because anticonvulsants, you cannot stop them immediately. If you stop all of them together, there is a huge possibility that you get a seizure. But I got all right by almost 1 to 1.5 years. I did get all right. So I did have, specific tasks assigned to me, which I could work on, which I could really work on. And yeah, now I'm normal. I'm able to work like any other normal team member.
How did this entire experience, I'm sure this 1 year would have been very difficult and very challenging for you in a lot of ways, but how has this experience changed your outlook towards life after the treatment, right? You know, before and after, like how have things changed?
So certain key things that I would still like to the audience is that, just as you mentioned, confidence is very important. So the positive attitude and confidence in patients is most important. And okay, that plays a more major role than what the medicines that you take. You have to first remember that. The confidence that you are having is going to help you much more than the medicines that you take. And today cancer is nothing, you know, the medical field has improved so much that it is possible to cure cancer. There are certain other ailments which are more difficult to treat than cancer. So remember that and first get the feeling in yourself that you will be cured. Second thing is, please stop bothering about the small inconveniences that happen, like, you know, hair fall. It's a temporary thing and you are going to get your hair back in some time. So don't worry about these minor inconveniences. Focusing on certain hobbies which will help you keep engaged, and you know your thought process will be there. Start drawing, start taking photographs, something like that. Or if you would like to visit places, do that so that you are engaged somewhere. And please avoid watching movies that develop a negative attitude, movies that say that, oh, this person got this. You know, that's not really going to happen. Avoid internet, avoid searching in internet about what you have, because sometimes, right, they give a false prognosis there. When I went and saw, it was telling me that, the prognosis is 18 months and today it is, you know, it's almost going to be 7 years since my treatment. So please don't go to those websites and read, you know, such nonsense. Instead, please spend time on certain hobbies, you know, which will make you feel more calm and, pleasant. And, people, no, they are more disturbed when you get cancer and they want to make you feel all right and tell you you'll get all right. And they sympathize with you a lot. If you want to avoid them, please avoid them. If you have already developed a mindset that you are getting all right, please avoid people who will again push you down. Just ensure that you are on the proper mindset and don't get disturbed by others. If you find somebody is disturbing you, please avoid them. And one more thing is, trust God. I mean, if, I don't want to, you know, compel this to an atheist, but if you trust God, you know, trust God. When you trust God, that gives you some morale boost, that gives you some confidence. I have felt it and that's why I'm saying it. So all this will help you. And remember one thing that you can achieve. Just because you're a cancer survivor doesn't mean that you cannot achieve. And you don't become less than anybody just because you're a cancer survivor. So you can achieve. Remember that and keep that as your motive always behind you, and that will help you recuperate, you know, faster.
Thank you so much for beautifully summarizing the last point. I think the 5 to 6 points that you mentioned are going to be very relevant and useful to any cancer patient or caretaker who might be watching this video, right? With that, I would like to thank you, Chitra, for coming on to this show and helping us, you know, inspire and educate more cancer patients. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Raghuveer. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you.